Alrighty, folks, we have the man, myth, the legend, Brian Adamson with us. It's so important for him to be a part of the channel each week that he's taking this one from the road on his phone, and we appreciate you for doing that. Brian, how are you?
I'm doing well, man. And just to preface the conversation, I just left an elder meeting at my church. I'm sitting in the executive pastor's office, so Mike, no F-bombs today, all right? I just want to put that out there.
Deal. I promise you, I can control it. There'll be no F-bombs. But why don't we talk about something that we see consistently. I've seen it for 20 years. I undoubtedly think you and I will see it for the next 20 years. And that is what I sometimes call information overload. Maybe you call it information paralysis. But why don't we talk about what it is, how to identify it, and then maybe how to rectify it? Because I really do think it's a three-step process.
For sure, for sure. I think we need to go out and get educated. I think networking, going to seminars, going like all of that stuff is requisite if you want to be successful in business, right? But there comes a point in time where you can't think your way to success. The only way you win is by actually taking the action, because action is the only thing that brings clarity. So what happens is people turn into information junkies and they subscribe to this methodology and this ideology and this and this and that. And then they get to a point where they got enough conversation and intellect to have, you know, good conversation over coffee or water cooler conversation at work. But what does it matter if none of it is digestible and practical enough for you to go out and start taking action steps? And so we at some point need to move away from information consumption and get into a place of practical application of the information we've already consumed.
Yeah. It's funny you bring this up, because one of the things I did this morning, I was lucky enough to be invited to be one of 50 speakers at a virtual event September 6th through 8th called Real Estate Wealth Con 2023. Mm. And I actually looked through the list of the other 49 presenters, and they did a great job. It's the who's who of real estate gurus, and they all have individual topics. So when I look at that, I go 50 unique topics from 50 amazing speakers. All I can see is, to your point, information overload.
Yeah.
All of them are going to get you excited. Half of them you're going to connect with, and you're going to go nowhere. I actually started my presentation, which they asked me to talk about single family homes, right? One rental at a time, kind of makes sense. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, let me just tell you what's going to happen. You're going to watch my speech, my talk track, get excited. Then you're going to watch 49 others and you're going to be excited by half of those. And you're going to do nothing, because you're going to be following squirrels or chasing butterflies or shiny pennies or whatever the heck it is. And you're going to go nowhere. So as I closed my session, I'm like, if you're still with me, you're going to do this. Basically, ignore everything else, get a buy box, look at it every day. If you do that, you can be wealthy. If you get excited by three or four or seven other things, you're going nowhere. I can't help you. So it's funny we're talking about this today, because I recorded that at like 7 a.m. this morning. It's funny that we're talking about this at, 9:30.
Oh, wow. Well, first of all, congratulations, Mike. That's a big honor, man, and well-deserved for you to be there to speak. I think the other part is, for our perfectionists out there, right? It's being a perfectionist is a dressed up form of procrastination. Just a sexy form of procrastination. And the truth is, by staying in student mode for so long and trying to have all the answers to the test before you ever take it, it just doesn't work. Even last week, right? I was in, we missed each other last week, cause I was in Tampa at a conference all week. And my God, just a wealth of wisdom and information and practical. So my issue isn't that I don't have enough stuff to do. It's what's the one, two, or three things that I'm going to execute on immediately, right? Mm-hmm. I've got pages and pages upon pages of notes in my phone, but I'm not confused to think that I'm going to be able to go back and do all of that. And so I have to look at, where's my business at today? What are the one, two, or three things that move the needle for me the most in the shortest amount of time? And those are the things I need to double down on and focus on and refer back to the other pieces later, where I can add them in after I've gone and executed on these things first.
Yeah, it's just funny. So first and foremost, both you and I have been doing this a long time. Both you and I have earned financial freedom. and we're still investing in ourselves, right? You're talking about an event you did last week. I did an event 3 or 4 weeks ago, not where I was speaking, where I was in the audience. And like you, we have the same situation. We hear all these speakers, we get excited by stuff. But to your point, I go back to the room at night. This is just because I've been doing events for 25 years as a sales guy. I would always go back at the end of the day when the information is still fresh. I would get quiet for about 20 or 30 minutes and I would find the one or two most important things from that day. I have pages. I like to write first my phone, pages of notes. Every day I look for one or two. Let's say the event is 3 day long. I have 6, maybe 7 things. Then what I do on the plane trip home is I find the one or two of the 6 or 7, and that's it. You just can't do everything. I know everything's excited, but you can't. So don't try is my advice.
100%, because a master of many is a master of none.
Oh, very well said. So let's talk about how to identify it, because I think we've now acknowledged what it is. How do you identify it? I think it's easiest to identify it in others, but how do you know when you get into that mode? How do you identify it yourself?
Quite honestly, I think the way in which I'm wired, like I score 99 as an achiever on the Enneagram test, right? Which means that unless I'm executing, I feel unfulfilled in life. And so I know when I've consumed too much information, because if I can't take that and codify it in such a way to take an action step, then I feel unfulfilled and overwhelmed. So the easiest way for me to identify is when I feel overwhelmed is typically because I haven't achieved something with the information that I've had, and it's bringing me to a point of paralysis. And that's an uncomfortable space for me based on how I'm wired. So for me, then I have to go out and take an action step, and all of a sudden I feel a little relieved. And then I take another one and it's like, okay, hold on, I'm starting to get some momentum. And I look up and it's like, oh, wow, this thing is rolling.
Yeah, I like that. The thing that I do now, and again, this is just me, it may not work for the audience, is anything that I do now has to leverage what I already have. I'll use Airbnb as just an example. So in 2019, I was working with a guy named Kyle in Fresno. He's gone on to do big things in the Airbnb market. But he was getting his footing. And he was like, hey, Michael, you just bought this property. It was in a great part of town. It was 2 units, 2 houses. And, you know, he knew that I was going to make it a monthly rental and my cash flow would have been, I don't know, $250 a month, whatever it was. He's like, Michael, I really think if you do this as an Airbnb, 2 rentals, you're going to make $2,000 a month. And obviously, I like money. So I thought about that. And I brought it home to Olivia. It was interesting enough for me to bring to Olivia, which not very much stuff makes it past that filter, but this one did. And she looked at it. We talked about it. And the answer was we would go from being what made us comfortable and brought financial freedom to an entirely new business. It is not even treated the same by the IRS. You are a hospitality business, not passive investors. And she looked at me and basically said, do you want to start something new at this point? And again, I admit we're lucky to be where we are. We don't have to make these decisions. But at the end of the day, I went back to Kyle and said, you know what? No, because I didn't want to start something new, at least that part. Because again, it would have consumed me. That one house or that 1-2 unit would have taken my eye off the prize. It would have prevented me from looking for deals. I would have had to spin up new this and that service. It probably would have worked, but it would have been disaster when I looked at the scale of my other stuff, in my opinion.
That's such an interesting perspective. I got this saying that even distractions look like opportunities.
Ooh, I like that.
Right. That probably should be a t-shirt or something one of these days. But even
it should.
Even distractions look like opportunities. And I think that without having a clear vision of what your goals are and what your plan of execution is, you'll constantly be distracted by things that look like opportunities, right? And as you know, Mike, the more and more successful that we become, the more opportunities pop up and present themselves. And so without having that narrow focus and that linear focus on what you're doing, then you will never get anything accomplished because you'll be chasing everything that's put in front of you. And so, you know, I think if I could make an assumption, the reason for the viewers that they're like, well, hold on, why would that be such a big distraction for Mike? It's because how we do anything is how we do everything. If you're going to embark on this Airbnb journey, you're not just going to do it by the way. You're going to take a deep dive in it. You're going to do the work. You're going because we actually practice what we preach. So you're not letting yourself off the hook. And you like, do I really want to become an entrenched student of Airbnb at the level that I'll need to in order for me to feel like I did my proper due diligence?
Exactly. Exactly. Well, now let's talk about the cure or the prevention or whatever you want to call it. I'll go first on this one. This for me is, I mean, this is my superpower, focus and daily discipline, mm-hmm. right? It is my buy box. I looked at a buy box that was so narrow for 3 years, 3.5 years, that I knew it better than any human alive after 6 months. That is where value, and really what, when I say this, what people don't hear is it gave me permission. No, it required me not to look at anything else. That is what a buy box is, and that's why it's so powerful for me.
Mm. That's powerful stuff, Mike. I think the question people have to ask themselves is, if I said that I was going to go out and accomplish buying my first property, for instance, how long have I been saying that? And what have I been doing to support the narrative of that actually happening by said date? And if the only thing I've been doing is watching YouTube and going to conferences and reading books and attending webinars, and I haven't taken at least one action step, so much so to even call an agent or call a lender and start to, that's a form of taking that. Like, taking action isn't buying the property, it's doing the work. And if you can really sit and say that I haven't done those things and I've been thinking about them, then you're missing the mark. And it's time to get to work. It's time to get to work.
I couldn't agree with you more. Brian, you put out a lot of amazing stuff. You're helping thousands and thousands of people every week, month, and year. How can people follow you and be part of your journey?
For sure. You can follow me at Brian Adamson Real Estate on YouTube and Brian Adamson Official on Instagram.
Folks, give him a follow on Instagram and YouTube. Tell him you came from One Rental at a Time. That way he knows his half hour with us each week is valuable and he'll keep coming back. Thanks, Brian.
Thank you.